The last part of my weekly health routine has to do with exercise. I like to mix up my weekly exercise routine with aerobic exercise, high-intensity training, strength training, and yoga and ballet exercises. I usually do some form of exercise every day, even if it's only 15 minutes. I usually like to do a 20 to 30-minute sauna session 3 times a week, but I recently moved and have not gotten back into the sauna routine, but I hope to change that soon. Usually I go for about a 3-mile run about 3 times a week. I'm not really an endurance athlete, clearly, but I do enjoy it for the cognitive boost it gives me. Whenever I have a big decision to make or something that's causing me anxiety, these are times I'm especially enthusiastic about going for a run. Aerobic exercise has been shown to increase the growth of new neurons in the brain by twofold. Aerobic exercise, even starting in midlife, has been shown to almost completely reverse the structural changes that occur in the brain with aging. It has been shown that 20 to 40 minutes of aerobic exercise can increase serum-derived, brain-derived neurotrophic factor in healthy men by up to 30%. And similarly, even 15 minutes of aerobic exercise can increase some brain-derived neurotrophic factor, albeit to a lesser extent. Brain-derived neurotrophic factor robustly increases the growth of new neurons in the brain, and sort of interestingly, in the muscle, it plays a role in repairing damaged muscle. It combats brain atrophy, which actually begins at 20 years of age, and by the time a person reaches 100, if they do, they usually have lost on average about 20% of their brain mass. Brain-derived neurotrophic factor is also good for combating brain atrophy by growing new neurons. It also has been shown to help prevent neuropsychiatric disorders like bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, depression, good stuff that you don't want in short supply. To try to get a little bit of high-intensity workout, I'll do squat jumps for a few minutes at a time. High-intensity training has been shown to improve learning and memory, and when done for 8 to 20 minutes, it increases the production of neurotransmitters, glutamate by 5% and GABA by 7%, as well as norepinephrine, which again is a catecholamine involved in focus and attention. Interestingly, the production of norepinephrine is also associated with the amount of lactate generated from the high-intensity workout. A highly vigorous exercise causes demand for energy to become too high for the mitochondria to use glucose or fatty acids to generate energy. So, glucose is used as energy without the mitochondria via a process called glycolysis. Lactate is then produced as a byproduct. Lactate is very similar to ketone bodies in that it is transported to other tissues, including muscle, brain, heart, liver, utilizing the same transporter known as the monocarboxylate transporter, which is used by ketones. Then lactate is able to shunt into the mitochondria to be used as an energetically favorable source of energy, such as in the brain, where it can then be used preferentially as a source of energy by norepinephrine-producing neurons. This idea that we can use lactate possibly produced by our muscles to help out brain tissue or other tissues not responsible for its generation is known as the lactate shuttle theory, which is an idea that was pioneered by Dr. George Brooks, that lactate produced by the muscles might be used or shuttled elsewhere. In addition to squat jumps and running, I also lift some weights and do lunges and squats with weights either 2 to 3 times per week. It is really important to maintain muscle mass. Starting in middle age, people lose between 0.5 to 1% muscle mass per year. One study involving over 300 twins speaks to the importance of legs in particular. Greater strength and power in the legs in particular was associated with an increased brain volume 10 years later and less brain aging in over 300 twins. Other fitness measures besides that of legs, such as forced expiratory volume or grip strength, were not associated with brain aging when leg power was excluded. Other lifestyle and health measures, such as frailty and telomere length, also indicated that reverse causation was not likely. So to get right down to it, don't skip leg day. Lastly, I do some yoga and ballet exercises 3 to 4 days a week. I really like to do these exercises because they increase my flexibility and tone very specific muscle groups. I like it, but your mileage may vary.